a short example on image processing, and after that I will have a few options for you, and you can actually choose what you want to hear for the rest of the afternoon. So we finished vector analysis or vector introduction to GRASS, and now I want to continue with an introduction to image processing. In this example, we are using Landsat ETM, which is already included in your sample data set. First, we will prettify the color tables or create a nice looking coloring scheme. That means we will skip this part, open graphical display, because we are working exclusively through the graphical user interface. Okay. We are done with this. I clear up everything I have here. Remove this layer. And now we go to settings, region, set the region. And we select any of these Landsat bands. They are all equal in extents and resolution. They are located, maybe a short note in the on the naming convention here. What you see here is the name of the raster data, then comes this at, and after that comes the name of the map set where these data are located. So I'm now working in the map set called user one, and these data are located in the map set called permanent. So here you see the full name, so to speak. It's kind of first name and surname. And again, I want to see what's happening and print, go to print and activate print the current region. Okay. No.
I don't find the data.
You don't find the data?
I looked, you have them on the permanent already?
Yes. You don't?
I think I must import rough
data. No.
So,
settings.
Settings.
Region, set
region.
Yes. Not this one. To match raster map, the second entry. Yeah, there they are. Okay, existing. You must use the second option here. The first, we can actually define a region and save the region, give it a name and save it somewhere for future reference. And then again, set the current region from these saved settings. We can also set the region from a raster map, from a 3D map, from a vector map. For a vector map, actually only the extents will be used, because a vector map doesn't have any inherent resolution, obviously. There are various other options. We can also manually define north, south, west, and east, and the resolution and everything, but most of the time It is easier and actually more accurate to simply use an existing data set. In this case, we use these raster data, the Landsat data. Okay, everybody has this. Run. And now we see here the typical Landsat settings with a resolution of 28.5 meters. And the extents, and we have, this is a small sample data set only with a few hundred rows and columns. Okay, the example was now to prettify color tables based on histogram analysis. The command is i.landsat.rgb. This command, I means imagery command, so we go to the imagery menu entry. And there it should be under Manage Image Colors. Then we select this color balance for RGB. In GRASP, there are a number of modules that are specific for Landsat data pre-processing. You can also search for them in the manual to see what is available there. Or also use the search module functionality. So, we start with that. We need a red, green, and blue channel. In the example, we use the standard. So, band 1, Landsat band 1, is equivalent to band number 3. Green is equivalent to band number 2. And blue is equivalent to band number 1. Of course, we could also use a false color composite, for example, use the band 3, 4, 5. Which would give a different image, but with different information, for example, useful for vegetation. But here we just use the standard options. Click on Run. And it's finished. You all get something like this, some output like this? No. G region. Settings, region, set region. Your system is German, if I'm correct. Yeah. So I think it's called Arbeitsbereich. Yeah.
I'm not getting the meter data.
Yes. You know, you need to go to print or drucken. There's a special tab. And you must explicitly tell it to print, otherwise it runs like silently and doesn't print the new settings. Okay.
It's the problem that I have during all graph operations, actually. I get no version information available error all the time for this. Yes, for this library.
Mm-hmm.
I've compiled it from source. Well, everything works, actually. I hope this one does not really give the same output, but that could be the version perhaps. It's set to rules, it does only say command finished. So. But and here it is everything that is. I have it from the start actually. When I start grass, it's one of the first things it sets, but I can get prompts and do everything in the meantime. But everything I do things in the guide.
Can you type gdal info -- version? Yes. Okay, that works. Gdal info -- format. Okay, formats.
It needs more.
Yes, an S is missing.
Formats.
Yes, okay, this is also working. I can help you with that afterwards. This will take a little bit of time.
Yes.
It depends on how and how you install the Project 4 library and the GDAL library, if you compiled that from source or not, if you pulled it in from the repositories. Okay, and how you compiled grass. So something is strange there. I haven't seen that. Can you do the GDAL version info -- yes, version again? Yes. 1.11. Okay. Whoa. Brand new. We will have a look at this later on, if you want. But as long as the module finishes successfully, there shouldn't be a problem. Yes?
I also don't get for this one the printed output there. It makes sanity.
The output is also like this for me. So did I have a Häkchen vergessen oder sowas?
Nee, das könnte okay sein. Kannst du mal auf optional gehen? Optional.
Also das habe ich auch schon mal versucht, aber...
Passiert auch nichts?
Also es ist das Gleiche, ne?
No, it should be okay. We will see. Okay, after that... Hallo. Now we display, we add, now not just a simple raster layer, but we go to this button, add various raster map layers, and we want to add an RGB map. So I select add RGB map layer. Okay. Okay, red will again be band number 3, green will be band number 2, and blue will be band number 1. And then I go on okay. So the display has still been set in my case to the 1 meter LiDAR dam, that's why it looks so pixelated. If I click now on this button here, zoom to selected map layer, it should show me the full extent. Yes. So here we have the full extent of the RGB, of the Landsat data, and this is a RGB display. Is anybody not seeing something like this? No? Okay. We can also add on top a false color composite, as I just mentioned, using different bands. This will most probably result in a 4-5-3. Now I use as red band number 4, as green I use band number 5, and as blue I use band number 3. This looks now vastly different. Just a quick example, so if I deactivate this, we have forested areas, for example here, or everything that appears pretty much dark is forest in this example. And if I activate this false color composite, forest is picking out, sticking out as this dark orangey stuff, because we used bands, landside bands 4 and 5. They are corresponding to chlorophyll activity, and therefore this is a first indication for forested areas. Okay. The first pre-processing was we should what you can do is let me illustrate. I deactivate this. I remove the color tables from the Landsat bands again. You don't have to follow me on this here. I just want to demonstrate the difference. Okay. No difference? Do I have? Now, this is tricking me. No difference. Funky. What has Markus done there? Sometimes Landsat bands, especially this false the composite RGB, would appear very dark overall. You don't see these bright spots. Though this i.landsat RGB will adjust the color tables based on histogram equalization, but I have the suspicion that these input data have been pre-processed quite a bit for the sample data set, so they already look nice. Sorry for the not very illustrative example. Required. Let me try something. Settings. Great. Okay, now we see something. This would be the standard color interpretation for 8-bit imagery. So the each channel here, each band, has values between 0 and 255. If we would interpret these values directly as grayscale values and then translate this to an RGB image, we would get this appearance. But if we do, we have various ways to adjust the color table. One would be the iLandsat RGB, which is doing histogram equalization adjustment, then you see the difference. Another possibility is that you set the color table for these bands to go from, so the standard would be 0 is black and 255 is white. But you can also set it for each band individually, that the minimum is black and the maximum is white. And the maximum is usually not 255, but much lower. And then we get actually something very similar to this image. One example of the map calculator would be to calculate the normalized difference vegetation index. The map calculator can be run from the command line. This is a standard mathematical formula, nothing particular. But you can also use the interface, the raster map calculator. So I want to create a new new grid called NDVI. First, I type 1.0. This is a little trick to enforce floating point result. So the formula again is band number 4 minus band number 3 divided by band number 4 plus band number 3. I select here band number 4. Okay. Minus band number 3. Close bracket divided by, yeah, you can also insert all these. So what you could now do to save a little bit of typing and clicking, copy, go to the back, paste, and change the minus to a plus. Okay, so this is band number 4 minus band number 3 divided by band number 4 plus band number 3. Run. Looks funny. This is the default rainbow color table that has been applied here. And I want to use a different color table, so I go again on set color table, colors or define in Grass 7. And DVI should be somewhere existing. Here it is. Run. Now I have a nice NDVI, standard NDVI color table. Okay. Questions? Did the map calculator work for you, or did you experience problems with the... map calculator? Worked okay? Cool. This map calculator is a very powerful tool. This is now a really, really simple example. You can do lots of very fancy stuff. Actually, quite a few GRASS modules are scripts that use internally this raster map calculator to do some more advanced processing. Okay, close.
Can you export in map display to print?
Yes, there are two buttons. At the two buttons here, save display to graphics file. Or you can also print the display, then it prints really just what you see here. Okay. Okay, image classification. We are not doing this now. I just want to show or illustrate some, mention some methods that are available in GRASS. So we have unsupervised and supervised classification modules. I.cluster, I.class, I.gensig and gensigset for pre-processing, like defining spectral signatures, either unsupervised or supervised, and after that doing the actual classification. MaxLig is a maximum likelihood method based on the signatures determined here, or SMAP is a SMAP-based image classification. I think this is very similar to ISO data. So, yeah, just to mention that there are different methods to do image classification. What we have done here with the Landsat data, usually, obviously, all the different Landsat bands, they belong together. So you can, in GRASS, put all the Landsat bands in a so-called imagery group, which is a container for all bands of one Landsat scene that belong together. And for these, for most imagery modules, the image data must be first listed in a group, which is often done automatically during import. So when you import Landsat data, they are quite often automatically put into a corresponding group. Related to image classification, we have now object recognition with I.segment in GRASS 7, which identifies objects, and after that it is possible to do object-based image classification. Okay, just to illustrate some image classification procedures. We can also do author rectification in GRASS, but only of aerial photography, not yet of satellite imagery, because satellite imagery usually uses a scan line sensor, whereas aerial photography uses a different sensor similar to a standard camera. This is an example of biotope monitoring from digital aerial cameras generated with the SMAP classifier of grass. So here you see the original input, and this is the resulting output. This is actually a fairly old example. So this image classification functionality has been around for quite some time. Volumes, I have mentioned quickly, volumes or 3D voxel, 3D raster data. There's quite a bit of documentation on the GRASS website, also with examples and videos showing how to work with these 3D voxel data. There is also quite a bit of functionality. This 3D regularized splines with tension interpolation, or short RST interpolation, is quite sophisticated, has been around for quite some time and should be well tested. We can also do 3D map algebra, like the map calculator that we just used to calculate the vegetation index. There's 3D groundwater flow calculation possible, and also volume visualization with isosurfaces and profiles. But yeah, we are not going to do this in this course here. I want to quickly mention some possibilities how to interface R and GRASS. There are various possibilities. You can start R within GRASS. So first you start GRASS with a console, preferably, with a command window. And in that command window, you start R. You load the spgrass6 library, and then off you go. You can also do it exactly the other way around. You first start R, then you load the library spgrass6, then you initialize a GRASS session with spgrass6, and then you control GRASS from inside R. So you can do it any way around, either control R from inside GRASS or GRASS from inside R, whatever is more convenient. But you can also run the two in parallel, like do some processing in GRASS, export the data, and then immediately feed them into R, do further processing in R, and then transport the data back to GRASS if need be. So, yes. Yeah.
But my process takes so many time, and people said to me that it's better if I work directly in GRASS.
Sometimes. So, one example would be principal component analysis. This is you can do this both in GRASS and in R. The results are identical, but in GRASS it is much, much faster and it uses less memory. Of course, R is a full-blown statistical environment with all sorts of additional packages, and GRASS is nowhere close to providing all the R functionality. So sometimes we have duplicates. For example, in GRASS 7, we can also do multiple regression, which has a memory footprint of 2 MB maybe, independent of the size of the input data. It will never be more than 2 MB memory. And in R, everything is loaded usually to memory, unless you use the raster library, but then I don't know exactly if this is true. If you set up a general linear model and let it calculate, it can take quite some time and quite some memory. But, sometimes There is no universal answer to grass is faster and uses less memory. Sometimes it might be the other way around. And most importantly, grass does not have all the functionality of R. This is also nonsense, because duplicating functionality in two open source projects doesn't make sense, in my opinion. We are happy if someone implemented some functionality properly, and then we are rather using this functionality from someone else instead of re-implementing it, like inventing the wheel yet another time. So it depends.
So why do the people implement parallels? You know, people in open source, you have a lot of overlap.
Yes, I know. I think more effort should be put into projects similar to GOS. GOS is mostly a library. GDAL is also mostly a library. And GOS, for example, is used by QGIS, by GRASS, probably also by Saga, I'm not sure. And so you can make use of the algorithms used available in GOS, and then there they are. The interface is easy, and every desktop-like GIS package can make use of it. But historically, I think they were more or less stand alone, the different open source projects, even if they did similar functionality or had overlapping or similar functionality, and then everybody was implementing its own stuff. With GRASS in particular, as I said, GRASS, the very first release was in 1984, which is 30 years ago. So back then there was not much else out there, so pretty much everything was really implemented for the first time in GRASS, in a very GRASS-specific way. And the libraries of GRASS were not accessible to other projects because of the internal design of GRASS and so on, and therefore other projects came up with their own implementations, and then these common libraries are a relatively new development, relatively new. So one good example is Project 4. So most for handling projections and projection transformations, I guess that pretty much all GIS packages out there are now using Project 4 and not their own personal implementation for projection conversion. Actually, I know one project, the MODIS reprojection tool, is still using its own funky projection conversion stuff, but most other packages are relying on Project 4. So this is a one-stop shop for projection conversion. And Project 4 has been around for at least 20 years. So in GRASS, we are slowly switching over to making more use of GOS instead of implementing our own solutions, because GOS is just working. So
I have a feeling that this, what's really missing is a comparison. Most of things, they just go this direction or that direction.
Yeah.
And they don't go, for example, take, some ideological modeling. So if you could pick up four open source platforms.
Yeah.
And then you do a really solid comparison, and you could publish a paper on that. And then everybody will be able to see that. And kind of you will see that actually you cannot just cut out some things. You cannot say this was a bad direction, because
Yeah, to a degree. So sometimes, for example, when I worked on principal component analysis and multiple regression in GRASS, I used R as benchmark, not so much for processing speed, but for the results. The results must be identical because I assumed R, the results in R are correct. So I aim to produce exactly the same results. But for example, the principal component analysis in GRASS is producing only a subset of the possible outputs and diagnostics of R. Essentially, it's only producing the component scores, the eigenvalues, the metrics, and that's it. And in R, you get much, much more diagnostics and additional information. But for the purpose in GRASS, this is not needed. So I skipped all that, and I simply looked at processing speed. And that was the reason, in this case, this is the reason why we don't use R to do the principal component analysis. I did a benchmark, so I get identical results. In GRASS, it takes 2 minutes and 3 megabytes of memory. In R, it takes 30 minutes and 2 gigabytes of memory to produce exactly the same results. Because R, in this case, is not a GIS environment. So if you feed R with data with cases like 400 million cases, you get to the limits of R, but not in a GIS environment where these larger data sets are common. So that was a justification. For kriging, for example, I would never ever try to implement kriging in GRASS. I would always use the existing interface that we have, v.krige, which uses the R functionality to do the kriging. Yeah.
Can you repeat how you start GRASS from R?
Oops. How you start GRASS from R? First, you start R.
Yes.
Then you load the SPGRASS6 library, and there's a, sorry? Yes, exactly. Yeah. Then you need the function initGRASS to set the a few environment variables, the location of the GRASS database. You need to set the GRASS database, the location, and the map set, and then you can work with the GRASS data. If you start R from within GRASS, these environment variables are already set, and SPGRASS6 is reading them, and everything is fine. But if I remember correctly, this is really well documented in the manual of SPGRASS6, how to start initialize a GRASS session. And I guess I might have an example later on that. I'm not 100% sure. But the function would be init GRASS. Yeah, well, this is standard help GRASS, standard R syntax, read Rust6 to read GRASS6 raster, load an elevation dem, and so on. We are not doing this right now. I mean, this is standard R functionality. You're most probably familiar with that. SPGRASS6, as the name suggests, has been written with GRASS6 in mind, but I think it should also work with most GRASS7 modules. I haven't tried myself, but you have, okay.
You have to change something in the
connection, but cool. Yeah. Okay, that was the GRASS introduction. Now you have the choice. I have prepared another little exercise on elevation models, especially doing diagnostics on various different elevation models and see, compare them a little bit to see which one is more accurate and how to fix artifacts in elevation models. I would really like to give that or go through that. It's not very long. Optionally, I can also give a short presentation on new features in GRASS 7 compared to GRASS 6. This will be lecture only, no exercises, also not very long. And after that, I have an example on GRASS and R interaction on, I don't know if you know the sample data set MUS with the zinc concentration in soil. There, anyway, it's a more or less famous sample data set in R. Tom has done extensive exercises on this one, and I'm like re-cooking this in GRASS. So I would suggest that we now do either the DEM investigation, or I give a quick overview of our new features in GRASS 7. Which one do you want? New features, hands up. DEM, hands up. Okay. DEM it will be. Yep. Okay, so this is about data inspection. This is all based on SRTM elevation models or SRTM derivatives. Quick reminder again. Spatial raster data are defined by the number of rows and columns, this is fixed, the extent and the coordinate reference system, and also the data type. Is it integer data or floating point or whatever? And yeah, so these are crucial. If anything of this is missing, we don't know where on Earth the data are located, or where on the Moon, or where on the Mars, wherever. So, a common, very common source of elevation data still nowadays are SRTM data, which arise from the Shuttle Radar Topography mission back in 2001. The NASA has itself released versions 1, 2, 2.1 and version 3. Version 3 only recently. Version 3 is really cool. It's gap-filled, seamless, complete, mostly error-free. Then we have the USGS GMTED 2010, this is the Global Multi-Resolution Terrain Dataset. This is a resampled version of the original NASA data. The NASA data come at resolutions of 1 and 3 arc seconds. This beast here comes at resolutions of 7.5, 15, and 30 arc seconds. So this one is really nice if you work with climatic data, because climatic data practically never have a resolution of 30 meter. Climatic data, you are happy if you have a 1 kilometer resolution. Then there was, it looks like they stopped producing new versions, that CGIR, SRTM versions 3, 4, and 4.1, but they stopped producing new versions in 2008. They attempted to fill the gaps and make the SRTM data available in a more convenient format, namely in GeoTIFF and in larger tiles. So, yeah, this was the famous SRTM mission with a shuttle and a big antenna, and then recording the Earth, scanning the Earth with these two sensors, then calculating the dam from it. Asta. This is the Asta Dam, global Asta G Dam, is now at version 2. It's also a good data set, but version 1 of the Asta G Dam had lots and lots of artifacts. You had many hundred meter high skyscrapers in the middle of nowhere and so on, or big crates. But this has all been eliminated in the latest version. So the Asta G Dam data are now also pretty good. They have actually been used with care to produce this SRTM version 3 data to fill the gaps there, amongst other data. Okay, SRTM dam coverage, probably. You're probably familiar with that. Lots and lots and lots of small tiles, 1 by 1 degree tiles. I wanted to give an example on Bergen, on this location here, but unfortunately, Bergen is just a little bit north of 60 degree north. So we start a few kilometers south of Bergen. So we have two sources. I'm using here NASA SRTM version 2. This is Norway, southern Norway. Bergen would be somewhere here. And here we already see there are quite a few gaps in these fjords. The radar didn't penetrate well into these deep fjords. This is the CGRR version of SRTM. Okay, let's compare the two. You need to extract the data. They are in the folder in that archive called dem.zip, which is also available on the course, on the website of the course. I am closing my GRASS session here. This archive, dem zip archive, has these contents after you unpacked it. And I'm also unpacking this SRTM version 2 thing. And the contents are 4 of these original SRTM tiles. Okay. Everybody has this unpacked and found the same contents? Fine. Then all the SRTM data, they are in latitude, longitude with WGS84 as datum and ellipsoid. That means we start a new GRASS session. So we close the previous GRASS session and start GRASS anew. and get this welcome screen. Sorry. Is everybody there? Okay. Now we go on the location wizard and we define a new location. I give this location the name geos.ll. I like to, because a location is defined by its projection or coordinate reference system, I often put an acronym for the projection in the location name. LL in this case stands for latitude longitude. Everybody there? You can give it any name you want, obviously. Now we have various different ways or options to define the coordinate reference system. We can use the set the parameters from a list. We can use an EPSG code, which is highly convenient. We can also use an existing georeference data file to adapt this its CRS. We can also use a well-known text file, project 4 parameters or whatever else. We can also use a generic, well, with unknown projection, a simple XY coordinate system. In this case, we use the first option. Go on next. The projection code would be latitude longitude. Okay, everybody there? Next. Nothing to do here. Next. We scroll to the very bottom and use the most common WGS84 datum and ellipsoid. Next. Okay. This is datum transformation, which is in this case not really needed. We get this little summary in project 4 definition. And that was it. Now we have defined the coordinate reference system. Click on Finish. Now we get here a question. Do you want to set the default region? No, I don't want to do that now. And I do want to create a new map set. In this case, I call it Bergen, even though the data are not exactly on Bergen, but at least close enough. Okay. Okay, Bergen. Now I have two locations listed here. The first location in my case is geos.ll. I have two map sets, Bergen and Permanent. If I click on the other one, this window is updated. There are the map sets that we worked previously. Okay. Geostat in Bergen, fine, select, and now we can start GRASS. Is everybody there? No? Abirt. Cancel. Okay, Bergen. Okay. Okay, activate. Click on Bergen. No, it's already on. Okay, start GRASS. Everybody? No, it's fine.
Okay, so I just started.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Now we import the original SRTM files, import raster data. In this case, they are not, this is one of the few cases that a data format is not supported by GDAL. So we use this SRTM height import. Import raster data module. Okay, then you get a window like this. You browse to the folder where you extracted this SRTM version 2 data, and you select the first entry. Or any entry, it doesn't matter. Okay.
Those have, do not have to be extracted.
No. But if I remember correctly, it doesn't matter if they are extracted or not, but you don't have to extract these. So. The extraction in this case is done internally by the module. So when you go to the NASA website, this is exactly what you download. You download these zip files. So it's a convenience for the user that you don't have to extract these yourself. Okay. I click on this thing, open. Now, there's a very, very long name in here. Let me have a look. Okay. Run. Has not edited. Okay. Now I want to. Display the beast. I see nothing. I zoom to. And I check this. Did the import work fine for you? No? Did you encounter an error here? In the output, what kind of error?
Unable to import.
Sorry?
Unable to import.
Can you here scroll there a little bit? Can you go on required? Can you click on browse again? Right. Ah, yes. Stupid thing. This is because your operating system is eating. The zip extension. Okay, open. Zip. Huh? No, no, no. Leave it. Leave it. Run. Can you go on required? Delete the zip extension. Yes, run. This is taking too long.
Again.
Can Can you open a standard Explorer, Windows Explorer?
Yeah.
No, Windows, oh, okay. Not internet.
Ah, sorry.
No, go back where you just were. This thing. Yes. Your documents, I guess.
Yeah.
Where was it?
And I put here.
Ah, I said, okay, go in SRTM version 2. Yes. This is a zip file. Why is this not existing?
Unzipped them and I have the same error without the zip. This thing can't find the file.
Try without unzipping. In your case, in this case, I'm really at a loss. Because the file is definitely existing. Can you go to the import? This one here, and required documents grass dot. Why do you have
Yeah, I don't know why it disappeared.
There should be 4.
Yeah, it disappeared actually.
Can you go to here? Class data.
Okay, let's see here. Yeah.
Delete this one.
Okay.
And okay. Extract this one again.
Okay. Close. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Have a look inside here.
Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Now.
Yeah. Dot zip. Okay. Yes. Mm-hmm.
But you know, it's not such a file. Yeah, it's, and it's disappearing.
It's eating. Boah. No, you need the extension, the full name, also with 8, h80.zip, yes.
Nice.
And can you click on copy? Go on the here in this window at the bottom. Yeah. Yes, and here paste. Yes. Great.
Oh.
This worked.
Oh. I think I've extracted and it says like I already exist, but it's not in my display.
Can you show me the layer manager, grass layer manager?
Yeah, I think it's here.
Ah, okay. You don't. You're on Linux. Okay.
Yeah.
Click on this add raster map. Yes. No, not out.
Okay, this one.
Yes. Yes. That one.
Okay.
Now go to the map display, and exactly, perfect, okay. There seems to be a funny problem on Windows, but there seems to be a solution.
Okay.
Extract again.
Yeah, it was extracting actually, sorry. Okay, I have here.
Okay, go to
okay.
Yes, copy. No, first okay. Required.
Okay.
Browse to the data where they are sitting now. You have extracted them to some.
So it's kind of like
this one, yes.
Okay.
Yes, okay. Okay, copy. Go to your grass layer manager, this one, okay. Go to command console, insert it here, paste, hit enter. No, it's eating again the file. Strange. This I don't understand why it's eating. This is only happening here. Is it working for you?
No, I'm still trying. Maybe I could change the directory. I'm in the map set is located at the DEM folder. Is that right, or do I have to go to the?
No, you create a completely new map set.
Yeah.
The DEM folder has nothing to do with the map set. Yes. Actually, for the grass data, like everything that is managed by grass, you should create a separate folder where there's nothing else but grass data. The raw data are somewhere here, and the grass data are somewhere here. That's the best, safest to organize. Is it working for you now?
Yes.
Okay, you were fine. And you? Also, and you. Okay. So for the lazy people, so, if you work on the command line, you can do something like this to import all four tiles automatically. Done. Sorry?
Can't see the command anymore.
Ah, okay. So this is simple shell script for tile in. Yes, yeah. In theory, this is possible on Windows also, but then you have to start grass with the command console.
Can you copy a comment from the window, from the import window?
from this window.
Yeah. Yeah.
Here, copy. Yeah. Copy. In this case, it copies the current command string, everything that is here, into the clipboard, and you can paste it somewhere else, and then construct your little script. So you need to import the four tiles that have been there. I guess everybody succeeded with the exception of you, which I don't know what is the problem. This is one very short for loop. So okay. Let's get display all the four tiles. Five, six. Five. Six. Okay. You can select or mark all in the layer manager all tiles at once with pressing shift. Well, select the upper one, hold shift, and then click on the lower one, then you have all tiles selected. Do you see something similar to this? Not yet. Sorry? Aha, okay. Okay. Have you loaded the four tiles to the display? Okay. Then click on the topmost, hold shift, click on the bottom one. Now right click, set computational region from selected maps. I have now selected all four tiles at once. And the current computational region is now covering all four tiles. If I now zoom to the computational region, I should see this. One step back. Okay.
If you just go on the icon, zoom.
Are you using Grass 6 or Grass 7? 7. This would be the icon with the. Okay. Delete, go out. Go on this one.
This one.
Zoom to computational region, yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Nothing changed. Okay, right click here. Right click. Set computational region from selected maps. Okay. Now again, click on this one. Yes. Yes. Okay.
Why was it?
You have not yet set the computational region to cover all four tiles. So first you have to do adjust the region and then zoom to the new region. So first set the computational region to cover all four tiles and then zoom to the computational region. Yes?
Yeah, I've set like.
Yeah.
Yep. And when I do this, let's do the same stop.
1, 2, 3. Can you go a little bit?
Oh, okay.
Up. It only picked one. Okay. Can you go to map layers? Click on the topmost, and no, on any other one. Yeah. This is. Okay. Click on deactivate one after the other again. Okay. Your shift key seems stuck.
Okay.
Okay, then we do it differently. Layer manager, can you go to the menu? Click on this one. Go here. To settings, region, set the region, existing, and now you select the first one. Okay. Okay, now you click again here, select the second one.
Okay.
Alternatively, to adjust the region, we can also go to settings, region, set the region, and select all tiles at once. This has exactly the same effect. Print. Okay. Yes.
Can you add rasters? Can you add more than one raster at a time to the display?
Yes. Add multiple rasters or vectors.
It is actually because
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know.
Could be interesting in a real situation.
Mm-hmm.
You have made something that works to have in both
sessions. I don't know if you... No, that I really don't know. I have never tried that before, so... I would need to try that myself. Okay, if everybody is seeing something like this, we can go into the coffee break, which is scheduled for now. Okay, not okay? Okay, okay, okay. Okay. This is a really weird problem. I cannot, I have no explanation why the data, the files are eaten in the process and they disappear. It's so. It's not a particular operating system problem because all the other people have the same. So I don't know. First time, okay.